Welcome to the best university in the world, Covenant University. I'm Abdul Buke, 300 level student of mass communication. Covenant University is a great starter of learning as we have awesome, conducive learning environment coupled with the high-tech facilities that make learning easy. We also have great faculty members. They have adequate knowledge and they are really ready to impact on every student. Also, I love hanging out with friends and SEA is a really fun place to be as everybody is ready to talk, laugh and play with you and the environment is really, really friendly. Then we have the spiritual aspect of our life in Covenant University. It is really empowering as we are fed through the word of God day to day. Then we have the Thursday chapel service, Tuesday chapel service, Sunday service, leading to great changes in our life and a stronger relationship with God. All this together make me love Covenant University.
Thank you. We glorify your name. want to commit this inaugural lecture to your able hands, for whatever that is committed into your hands, according to your word, that you shall keep, going to be a perfect thing. Let your spirit permeate and pervade the entire length and breadth of this auditorium. Let your spirit of understanding and wisdom and revelation bellow upon us in the name of Jesus. Whatever your heart desire is, whatever you have in mind concerning this great lecture, Father, cause it to find expression in our lives in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Sweet Holy Spirit, we want to hand over this event to you. Lead us on. Let the name of the Father and the Son be glorified through this lecture in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. For in Jesus' mighty name we pray. And amen. You may please be seated.
Thank you, the chaplain. We'll take the national anthem and the Covenant University anthem. See you, band, please. Please, can we stand to take the national anthem? Covenant University anthem. Please, we may be seated. Thank you, the Covenant University band. We'd like to properly situate the welcome, but before I call on the Registrar of Covenant University, may I establish the protocol for this fifth inaugural lecture of Covenant University. The Chancellor and Chairman Board of Regents, Dr. David Oyedepo, the Vice President, Education, Living Faith Church Worldwide, Pastor Mrs. Faith Oyedepo, members of the Board of Regents of Covenant University, the Education Secretary, Living Faith Church Worldwide, Professor Bridget Shokon, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Charles K. Ayo, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Taiwa Bioye, the Acting Registrar, Pastor Olamide Olusegun, other principal officers of Covenant University here present, our deans of colleges and School of Postgraduate Studies, the distinguished lecturer for today, Professor Israel Dunmade, distinguished members of Senate of Covenant University, faculty and staff, our distinguished guests, kings and queens in Hebron, members of the praise, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. At this point, I would like to invite the acting registrar of the university to please come for the introduction of key officers of Covenant University. Can we welcome Pastor Olamide Olusegun?
You are welcome to the fifth inaugural lecture of Covenant University. And my assignment is to introduce members of the high table this evening. And to my extreme left is the master of event, Dr. Akan Basi, is director of the Vice Chancellor's office. Next to him is the chaplain of the university, Pastor Charles Ikaba. And next is Dr. Omogbadegun Zakios Omogbadegun, who is the Director of Student Affairs. The next to him is Pastor Bayo Oladeyinbo, is the Director of Financial Services. Dr. Christopher Nkiko is next, the Director of Center for Learning Resources. To my extreme right is Professor Nicholas Omoregbe, Dean College of Science and Technology. Next is the Dean College of Engineering, Professor Samuel Undezo John. Next is the Dean College of Business and Social Sciences, Professor Iyoa, Francis Iyoa. And next is the Dean College of Leadership, Professor Charles Obologo. And the next is the Dean School of Postgraduate Studies, as Professor Shalom Chinedu. Next is the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Taiwo Abioye. And I move to introduce the speaker at this fifth inaugural lecture. That's Professor Israel Dunmade. And our own Vice Chancellor, multiple award winning Vice Chancellor, Professor C.K. Ayo. Once again, you are all welcome.
Thank you, sir. We moving to the next item on this program. The Vice Chancellor of Covenant University has just been introduced. And may I add that he's the third substantive Vice Chancellor of the university. Can we rise as we recognize and welcome the Vice Chancellor for his welcome remarks? The Vice Chancellor, sir.
You may please be seated. I recognize the Chancellor of Covenant University, Dr. David Oyedepo, who will be joining us in a short while. Permit me to stand on the already established protocol. I'm most delighted to welcome you to the fifth inaugural lecture of Covenant University, titled Sustainable Engineering a vital approach to innovative product development and community capacity building. This lecture couldn't have come at a better time than this, when the goal of the university for this year is tagged innovation, product development, and nation building. Also, you will agree with me that just this year, the whole world is transiting from the Millennium Development Goals to Sustainable Development Goals. Permit me to share this thought with you, that the difference between the developed and the developing worlds is lack of sustainable principles in the development of such nations. To my mind, the colossal failure of Nigeria in a number of fronts is traceable to the absence of sustainable strategies in our approach to nation building. Talking then about sustainable development, there are two concepts involved here. The concept of needs, which involves the needs of the world poor that requires attention, and the concept of limitation, which technology and social organizations imposed on the environment to meet the present and future needs. Succinctly put, that is, we're talking about what is to be sustained, what is to be developed, and the duration involved. There must be a time tag. Shall we all rise as we receive the Chancellor of Covenant University? You may please be seated. The Chancellor, sir, we are most delighted to have you in our midst today, even as we discuss the topic, sustainable engineering, a vital approach to innovative product development and community capacity building. Coming in the year, where the goal of the university is innovation, product development, and nation building. Not only that, coming in the year where we are transiting from the Millennium Development Goals to Sustainable Development Goals. It is my belief that the lecture of today will educate us all and set in the right perspective the required metrics to put Nigeria on the path of development. Ladies and gentlemen, like I was saying, sustainable development can aptly be presented in terms of what is to be sustained, what is to be developed, and the duration involved, because there must be a timeline specified. It gladdens my heart to discuss with you that looking at the project Nigeria, there was a time I was thinking about this in terms of sustainable development, and I came up with four W's. Where are we presently in our nationhood? That is, the situation, current situation. Two, where do we desire to be? The needs of the nation. Three, what do we have? The available resources, and I'm sure we are all mindful of this. And last but not the least, what do we do? The required reforms to transform Nigeria to properly situate it among the league of world leaders. Ladies and gentlemen, talking about sustainable engineering, putting it side by side the sustainable development goals, we know sustainable engineering is a vital tool towards the accomplishment of the various issues that we must work around in order to put the Nigerian history straight. Remember, we have learned from our Chancellor that it doesn't matter how long you go on a wrong road, until you retract your steps to be on the path of development, we may never get there. I believe the way out of the socio-political and economical as well as technological development of Nigeria is via sustainable development out of which sustainable engineering is key. On this note, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to this lecture. Sit back, relax, and enjoy yourself. Once again, you're welcome.
Can we applaud the Vice Chancellor one more time? The Chancellor, may I at this point invite the Acting Head of Department, Mechanical Engineering, to please come and read the citation of the lecturer for today, Dr. Oluseyi Ajayi.
Chancellor, sir, the Vice Chancellor, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, please permit me to stand on the existing protocol. I want to implore the lecturer for today to please rise and keep standing. Professor Israel Dunmade was born on Sunday, 3rd of March, 1963, in Inaugural, Irepo Odun local government area of Kara State. He attended Christ Anglican Primary School, Ijomoro, from 1971 to 1976, and Baptist Grammar School, BGS, his son Louis Singh, from 1978 to 1983. He obtained his first degree in agricultural engineering at the University of Ilorin in 1988. He enrolled for an MSc degree program in mechanical engineering at the University of Lagos between 91 and 92, and earned a doctoral degree, Doctor Engineering, in Environmental and Process Engineering from the Brandenburg Technical University, Cottbus, Germany, in 2001. Professor Israel Dumade's career began with his National Youth Service in 1988-1999 at the then Enugu State University of Technology, Abakaliki campus, where he was engaged as a teaching assistant in the Department of Agricultural Engineering. He joined the Federal Civil Service in 1990 as a research officer too, in the engineering division at the University at the Federal Institute of Industrial Research, Oshodi. He joined the Federal College of Fisheries and Marine Technology, Victoria Island, in 1993 as lecturer 3 in the Marine Engineering Department. He worked at the Federal University of Technology, Akure, otherwise known as FUTA, as a lecturer in the Department of Mechanical Engineering from 1994 to 2002. He was also engaged as a part-time senior lecturer in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, University of Adoekiti, in 2001 and 2002 academic session. Our Professor of Honor joined Mount Royal College, Calgary, that later became a university in 2003 as an industrial ecology instructor. He got his tenure in 2007 and was promoted an associate professor in 2009. He also became an adjunct professor at the University of Saskatchewan, Canada, in 2009. He joined Covenant University in 2015 as a professor of mechanical engineering. Professor Israel Dunmade has received a number of academic awards in the course of his studentship and career. These include the 1976 Best Graduating Student of the Year Award at Christ School, Ijomoro, a Dele Afolabi Scholarship Award for his secondary and first degree education between 1978 and 1988. In 1988, he won the faculty prize for the best graduating student in agricultural engineering. Between 1995 and 1998, he got a DAD doctoral scholarship, and in 2004, he got the Excellent Teaching Award by Mount Royal Students Association. He has served as a reviewer, associate editor, and editor of a number of journals, including Elsevier International Journal of Cleaner Production, International Journal of Production Economics, International Journal of Technology Transfer, International Journal of Ecological Economics, and International Journal of Innovation and Technology Management. He has also supervised and co-supervised many undergraduate and postgraduate students, both in Nigeria and Canada. Professor Dunmade is a certified professional engineer by APEGA, a certified project management professional by PMI. and a certified environmental sustainability professional by Eco Canada. He was registered with Corren in 1994. Is a member of many professional societies such as Nigerian Society of Engineers, Nigerian Institution of Microelectronic Engineers, Nigerian Institution of Mechanical Engineers, Nigerian Institution of Agricultural Engineers, Canadian Society of Mechanical Engineers, Canadian Society for Bioengineering, Canadian Network for Sustainability Indicators, International Society for Industrial Ecology, and American Society for Agricultural and Biological Engineers, otherwise known as ASABI. He has also served in professional leadership in various capacities. He was the Assistant General Secretary of the Nigerian Institution of Mechanical Engineers from 1994 to 1995, the Chairman of International Affairs Division of ASABI, and from 2008 to 2010, Chairman of Kishida Award Committee of ASABI between 2010 and 2011, Member of ASABI Communication Council from 2011 to 2013, Member of the ASABI Membership Council 2014 till date, and Chairman of the African Network Group of ASABI from 2008 to 2014. He has also been a member of the Board of Directors of the Canadian Bioengineering Foundation from 2011 till date, and member of the ASABI Resource Magazine Editorial Board from 2013 to date. Ladies and gentlemen, I hereby present to you the inaugural lecturer of today, Professor Israel Dunmade.
Please have your seat. Thank you. The Chancellor, sir, the Vice Chancellor, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Registrar, and I would like to stand on existing protocol. I first of all want to pay obeisance to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the author of wisdom, the all-knowing God. Hallelujah. I would like the PowerPoint to be put on, please. The title of my lecture today is Sustainable Engineering, a Vital Approach to Innovative Product Development and Community Capacity Building. The lecture outline is as follows. I will be talking about introducing the topic, give some definitions, and then I'll be talking about sustainable engineering and innovative product development. That will be followed by sustainable engineering and community capacity building. Then later on, I would like to situate where sustainable engineering is in relation to our covenant core values. Furthermore, I will be talking about pathways to sustainable engineering. I will also be talking about sustainable engineering opportunities in Nigeria, and then I will express my closing thoughts and recommendations. I would like to start this presentation by giving a short history of what a particular pastor, humorous pastor that was invited to Germany in 2001, what he said. When he got to Berlin, and after he met the guests, so he sat down, then he closed his eyes and opened his eyes. Then he said, if it is not that I was awake while I was traveling, assuming I slept all through and I woke up here, I would have thought that I finally made the rapture. So in essence, he was more or less amazed by things that he saw at his arrival. And I know that many of us have visited one place or the other that we were amazed at what we saw there. And there are some places where we have been and we feel that how I wish that certain things could be in place life would have been better. Well, I want you to know, if you have not known yet, that all those amazing things that you have seen, actually, they are the works of engineers. So, in other words, I would like to recommend engineering to your children or your wards if they are yet to make a choice of what course to do. Engineering is the application of scientific and mathematical principles for practical purposes. And such practical purposes include design, manufacturing, and operation of products and processes, while accounting for constraints such as the economic viability of such products or processes, the environment, as well as the sociological factors. Engineering activities have contributed a lot to our world. It has brought about technical advances, improvements in standards of living, as well as improving our well-being as a people and society. However, we find out that engineering makes use of resources to drive the world's economic activity. And we can find the work of engineers in virtually any area of our endeavor. Unfortunately, you find out that despite the contributions, the positive contributions that engineering has made, you also find out that there are some shortfalls, some unintended outcomes of our activities as engineers. And these are in the form of wastes that we release to the environment. So environment, the next slide, please. The environment is serving as a source for resources, and it's also serving as a sink for waste. According to the Principle 3 of the Declaration of the United Nations Conference on Human Environment of 1972 in Stockholm, it says man's capability to transform his surroundings could result in incalculable harm to human beings and the human environment. In other words, though we have good intention, there's a good purpose in mind in carrying out our activities as engineers, there are some byproducts of our activities which are not intended, but which could consequently affect humanity negatively and can also injure our environment. So there's a need to reduce or eliminate unsustainable patterns of production and consumption in order to achieve sustainable development and a higher quality of life for all people, as stipulated in Principle 8 in the Declaration of the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development in 1992 at Rio de Janeiro. Looking at consumption and production from a life cycle perspective for goods and services are very necessary in order to produce products that will result in sustainable resource management. For example, we can see that as the population increases, there will be need for more food because there are more mouths to be fed. We also find out that there will be need for more shelter, there will be need for more transport infrastructure, and all these things will require the use of resources from the environment, and in the process of transforming those resources, we will release some wastes. And many of these wastes could be injurious to our health. It can also negatively affect our environment. Furthermore, we find out that though the earth is providing us with resources, it is also serving as the burial place for our waste. There is a limit to the productive capacity of the earth in producing those resources. And there is also a limit to the absorptive capacity of the earth in assimilating and bringing about the decay of those wastes. So we need to watch the way we exploit our resources so that we don't experience a number of those things that we have been seeing in the time past. I would like us to move to the next slide, please.
bare foot, tiny hands, and nimble fingers. These children sift through rubbish, looking for anything valuable. For 13-year-old Bafo Che, who scavenges regularly here, it's dangerous work.
Sometimes I get hurt. I get cuts from the glass. I had one here under my foot.
Life for these young men here at a dump site in Ghana is risky business. Bafo and his friends burn wires from these old computers to retrieve precious metals like copper, gold, and silver. Many companies in Europe and North America ship obsolete computers and electronics to developing countries as donations. But the majority of the items are unusable. Called e-waste, they're discarded and begin to pile up everywhere. Experts say that e-waste is now the third fastest growing waste stream in the world.
E-waste is not simply something we should turn our eyes away from and ignore, because it is a mountain that is building up across the planet.
It is rather a disservice to ship all these waste end-of-life computers to Africa under the guise of donations or second-hand equipment.
And components like computer monitors and motherboards dumped in landfills contain lead, mercury, and other hazardous chemicals. Over time, these toxins seep into the soil, contaminating groundwater. UNEP encourages all countries to uphold the Basel Convention, which came into force in 1992. The convention, the first of its kind, stresses the need to responsibly manage hazardous waste, including e-waste, to save lives and protect the environment.
On the environment is a lot. It can lead to global warming, which consequently causes climate change. And it can also lead to ozone depletion. It can lead to cancer, birth defects, acidification, deforestation, and many other problems. The outcome of this is that something has to be done in order to arrest the situation. And that one of the things that could be done is to arrest the negative trend is a change from the current engineering way of doing things to the sustainable engineering approach. Next slide.
As a human being, you have ambitions, dreams, desires, wants, and needs. We develop, we produce, we consume. We build, we extract. We sell, we buy. But focusing only on economic growth costs us more than we gain, causing tragic consequences to society and the environment. War, famine, joblessness, natural and man-made disasters compound this trajectory. We can create economic growth while improving our lives and protecting the planet. We can harmonize our economic, social, and environmental progress to develop sustainably. We must transform our structures and technology so our economies adapt and our environment thrives. We can produce and consume sustainably to bring prosperity to our people and help our planet come alive. This is the story you are shaping.
Thank you. That will lead me to talking about definition and basic biblical principles of sustainable engineering. A number of definitions have emerged on what sustainable engineering is, but I would like to define sustainable engineering as an interdisciplinary and multifaceted approach to adaptive integration of supply side and consumer side of an engineered system over its life cycle stages by utilizing various methods in a technically sound, socio-economically sensible, and environmentally friendly manner. When we look at the Bible, it gives us some principles of sustainable engineering. Genesis chapter 1 gives a vivid account of our Father, the Godhead, as the master designer and the supreme manufacturing engineer. And you can see this wherever you go, whether you go to the mountains or you go to the edge of canyons. We find out that the way the natural world is designed gives us a clue as touching how the Creator wants us humans to manage the created world. And there are three basic principles that we can learn from from the natural world. The first one is collaboration. And we see this in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, where God the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit came together in creating man in his own image. Another thing that we can see, which is also basic principles of sustainable engineering, is the interlink of subsystems in cyclic manner. Whether you take the carbon chain, or the food chain, or the hydrological cycle, you find out that there is a kind of interrelationship between them, even though each of them are functioning semi-independently. And that is one of the basic principles of sustainable engineering. The third one is that little or nothing is wasted. And this is also biblical. We can see the example of this in John chapter 6, verse 12, where the Lord Jesus Christ said they should gather the crumb, nothing should be wasted. Next slide, please. So when you look at the natural ecosystem, you find out that there is interdependency between them. They depend on one another for survival, and each of them cannot live independent on the other. We also see the industrial equivalence, which also we are trying to mimic today, through which we want to practice sustainable engineering. So sustainable engineering gives every stakeholder the opportunity to share ideas and to think outside the box in arriving at an appropriate solution to an engineering problem that satisfies the majority's interests in that project. It encourages the consideration of the complete product and process life cycle during the design effort, with the intent to minimize the environmental impact across the entire life cycle, while simultaneously maximizing the benefits to the social and economic stakeholders. As you can see in the next slide, you'll find out how every stakeholder is invited to participate in arriving at a solution to a particular engineering problem. One thing that we need to take note of, which many times we don't, is that everybody have one thing or the other to contribute in finding solution to our common needs. And it is until when you give such people privilege to have their voice that you will know how rich the ideas are. I would now like to talk about life cycle concept, because I mentioned that earlier on. Life cycle concept implies the consideration of each step from the point of ideation of the system to the point of managing the end of life of the system. Next slide, please. So you see in that illustration, we start from the material acquisition point through to the retirement stage of the life cycle of a particular product or a process or a system. And we want to see how we can close the material cycle or the resource cycle. We want to ensure that we have minimal negative impacts, and we want to also increase the durability of that product and even consider the reusability and recyclability. I will now talk about sustainable engineering and innovation in product development. Human beings by nature We have desires, just like we watch in that video clip, and we all, no matter the level of our development, we will always desire something better. And it is this desire that is driving the manufacture and sales of products, and this will continue indefinitely. And because of such desires, we find out that a number of products that are generated or developed, they have some negative impacts which were not thought of at the time of considering the design. And that is why today we have a lot of problems all over the place, like you can see in that young man, those people that were scavenging the electronic dunghill. Because of the perception of this problem, we have groups which are called environmental groups that have risen up in recent years, and they are pressurizing the policymakers to bring engineers and product manufacturers to become responsible for the product that they are manufacturing. And because of this pressure, new legislations have been developed that put the onus on engineers, designers, and every stakeholder in product development to look at ways to prevent pollution and also to ensure that we reduce wastes. The process of developing such approaches is what we term innovation, because we now develop new way of doing things. And that is what is driving the current innovations that we have all over the world today. Sustainable engineering and innovation continue. Development of new ways of doing things in order to prevent the unwanted side effect of our effort that are aimed at making life comfortable for a generality of people is our innovation. So we need to address products, processes, and energy development. And it is the quest for this that have led to the development of a number of paradigms like green design, environmental conscious design, as well as environmental conscious manufacturing. However, we find out that anything green that we call green is focusing on the environment alone. But we find out that that is not sufficient enough, because it may be environmentally friendly, but if it is not socio-culturally compatible, if it is not economically viable, you will find out that it will not last long before we have to replace them. So there is a need to have a concurrent consideration of both the environment on one hand, the economic aspect, and the sociocultural aspect of it. Sustainable engineering is that aspect of engineering disciplines that employs various methods to improve products and processes in an innovative manner so as to make them more efficient concurrently from the environmental, sociocultural, and economic standpoint. And these have been resulting in innovations and inventions in our days. And this is expected to increase geometrically in the coming years. And I believe that you will have some breakthroughs if you also decide to imbibe the concept in your engineering endeavors. I would now like to talk about sustainable engineering and community capacity building. Community capacity building is referred to as the continuous process required to foster the pride and appropriate local leadership that allows communities through their members to take responsibility for their own development. Sustainable Community 2014. Community capacity building focuses on a number of things. Number one, building the skills and confidence of individuals and groups. When we believe in ourselves, it helps us to be able to think right. It helps us to be able to innovate and know that whatever the problem is, we can do something about it. Another focus of community capacity building is enhancing community decision-making and problem-solving processes. It also brings about creating a common vision for the future. Furthermore, it leads to implementation of practical strategies for creating change and promoting inclusion and social justice. How sustainable engineering facilitates community capacity building? Number one, by involving all the stakeholders throughout the life cycle of the project. You know, earlier on, I said everyone, regardless of their status in society, should be involved whenever we want to develop a system. And you never know, whatever the contribution they are going to make may be the one that will bring about the breakthrough, even though it may seem as if they are not learned. So sustainability implies examining issues from various angles, and because one person cannot have the perception of every angle, there's a need to bring various, all the stakeholders that are necessary in solving such problems. Consequently, individuals and groups in process of interacting with one another in evolving the solution to a problem, they also learn, and thereby they acquire new skills, develop their abilities in the process of their interaction, implementing the assignment that are given to them. Another way sustainable engineering facilitates community capacity building is by formal training of engineers and other professionals regarding how to incorporate such principles along with the various tools of their profession in addressing a given problem. I will now talk about sustainable engineering and our core value as a university. I will just talk about three of them. The first one is our spirituality core value, which hinges on the fear of God. Traditional engineering is focused only on meeting our current needs. In other words, when we see a problem, we want to solve it. So we consider that problem and we use various means to address that problem. But we don't think of what will be the consequence in the future. And that tends to be selfish. That's what I see in the way we approach engineering. Traditionally, meeting our own current needs at the expense of the future generation's capability of meeting their own needs doesn't connote our having the fear of God. So, wanton clearing of forests, causing resource depletion, and indiscriminate disposal of waste, which causes environmental pollution, will rob the future generation of the opportunity to enjoy the same standard of living that we have today, because they will not have the resources needed to maintain such level of affluence. And something has to be done in order to obey our Creator's directive in taking care of our world. And an effective way of taking good care of our world is by sustainable application of engineering principles in systems development and management. Another one of our core values is possibility mentality. In my little interaction with people here in our country, I observed that a lot of mental reorientation work needs to be done. If we look at it, many of us, we have the perception or the idea that, some other people are out there that can help us meet our developmental need as a nation. But we all know that nobody can care for you like you care for yourself. Another thing is that sustainable engineering provides us with a platform to transform our mentality, because we bring everybody on the table and everybody's idea is welcome, and we begin to look at how can we apply those ideas. Yes, everything may not work the way we expect. It is also part of learning. And we don't ask a child that is learning to walk to stop falling by not walking again. As we try to walk and we fall, we rise up and we walk again until when we become perfect. So, in other words, sustainable engineering will help us to attain technological development by our self-help and our faith in God. And adaptive sustainable engineering can also help us get there. Another aspect of our core value is the capacity building. Sustainable engineering being participatory and collaborative in nature facilitate shared knowledge among participants in a project, thereby building their capacity. As you can see, I don't know if you can see that illustration there, we need to pull each other up as we make progress, and that's very crucial. Now, how does sustainable engineering help us to accomplish all this? And that's what will lead me to talk about sustainable engineering pathways. There are a number of strategies that have been developed. A number of others are in the process of development. But sustainable engineering pathways can be divided into four groups or four categories. And that we can see in the table that is shown there. The first one is the design pathway. And it focuses on all the stages in the life cycle of a product or a process. And there are quite a number of paradigms that have been developed in the area of design. I will talk about three of them later. The second pathway is what we call process pathway. It focuses on the manufacturing stage of the life cycle of a product. And we have concepts like cleaner production, green manufacturing, and sustainable manufacturing as part of the paradigms under that category. We also have the third pathway, which is the management pathway. The management pathway focuses on the end of life or the retirement stage of a product or a system. This is a very crucial stage, and that's why we see the indiscriminate disposal of various products at the end of their useful life that is causing problems for us, problems for the environment, problems for our health. And in order to ensure that we stop that process, a number of paradigms have been developed, and this includes the concept of disassembly, the reuse, remanufacturing, recycling, and so on and so forth. And the fourth pathway is the assessment pathway. This is where we are trying to look at the various strategies in the sustainable engineering, how far they can help us in accomplishing our goals in order to be able to improve on what we have achieved so far. So we have concepts like life cycle analysis, social life cycle assessment, life cycle costing, risk analysis, material flow analysis, enabling resources, and infrastructural analysis. Out of all these four pathways, design pathway has received an overwhelming concentration or attention from scholars and researchers. And there are two reasons for this. Number one, over 70% of a system's life cycle characteristics and operation behavior are determined at the design stage. It's just like medical people say that the first 72 hours of a conception of a child is very important, because that's when the DNA is set in place. And once the DNA is set in place, whatever the behavior of that child will be in life is already determined. The same thing in engineering, you decide the characteristic, how the system will behave, either consciously or unconsciously at the design stage. So any other thing you want to do or correction you want to make is like bandaging the wound at a later stage. Another reason why the design pathway have reached an overwhelming interest is because every engineering discipline is engaged in one form of design or another, and they are employing numerous principles and mechanisms. So there's a need to infuse sustainability into each of these methods and mechanisms. I would like us to look at the next picture, which is figure 6. Slide, please. There you will see the illustration studio. Okay, thank you. So we see there the various, at the bottom you see the various design concepts and how they affect the end of life management of the system and where they fall into in the product life cycle. And you see how we consider the three aspects of sustainability in that particular concept. The next, this is a tea kettle that is designed for disassembly. If you look at the right side, you will find out that each of the components can be separated. And one thing I want you to take note of there is that they can be separated without using any tool. You can just, the employee push and pin. In other words, all that you need to do is just to pull. So you don't need to use a screwdriver or whatever tool. And what is the importance of that? Because you find out the maintenance or the reusability of a product depends on how long it takes to disassemble, because the technicians, they look at the number of hours they have to put into disassembling the work that they do, and they charge you for the repair. And you know that rational human beings, if you find out that the cost of buying a new product of the same type, as well as the repair, is the same. All that you do is to throw away the old and buy the new one. After all, you are sure of the efficiency of the brand new one. So in order to ensure that we take care of those resources that are in the product that we have designed that is reaching the end of life stage or that have developed some fault, we need to design in such a way that it is easy to pull them apart so that it doesn't take much time and it doesn't cost us so much. There are three design paradigms that forms the main pillar of sustainable design. They are design for disassembly, design for materials, and design for modularity. Design for the material, look at the material content of that product, and we want to minimize the numbers. And then the design for modularity is where we want to concentrate the functions. Each of the functions, we want to isolate them and want to concentrate them in specific places so that if there's fault, we can easily know where it is and we go straight there and we correct it without necessarily going to various parts and disassembling them without, I mean, which will cost more money to repair and more time to carry out our assignment. The second process pathway, which I talked about, try to prevent pollution of the environment and prevent it from affecting the populace negatively. The management pathway, seek to close the material loop, and we have two major approaches that we use there. The first one is eco-industrial development, which itself is divided into three parts. We have the eco-industrial parts, we have the eco-industrial networks, and we also have converted industrial estate or brownfield. Eco-industrial park, it consists of manufacturing facilities, just like industrial parks, that are co-located in a specific place. But the difference between it and the conventional industrial park is that the waste from one is serving as input for the other. The eco-industrial network is easier to form and maintain because it is they are scattered, but there are agreement, loose agreement between the corporate organizations to share their resources together and to exchange the waste. Next slide, please. So that is an example of eco-industrial park that is located in Kalundborg, Denmark. And the next slide, please. That is an example of eco-industrial network that consisted of 8 companies that I sent group of students to where I was teaching before for the companies that cooperate in exchanging their waste with one another. And the last one there, which is the assessment pathway, it shows the various steps involved in life cycle assessment, where we establish goal and scope definition. There we also, that is also followed by inventory analysis and impact analysis, then the interpretation. Now, I would like to talk about how do we evolve suitable solution for collaborative sustainable engineering process. Where the illustration may not be visible because there are so many things that are involved, but essentially the first step is in bringing together all the stakeholders and giving them the mandate to do certain things, and we give them the procedure for arriving at the solution. Then there is a choice of whether to buy or to make. In deciding whether to buy or to make, we look at what is existing locally. And this has been some of the areas that I have done a number of work with some corporate organizations in Canada before I relocated here, and it has brought about some savings in terms of economical aspect. It has also brought about the recognition of those corporations as corporate citizens. Now, I would like to bring home the concept of sustainable engineering opportunities here in Nigeria. Sustainable engineering concept is still new all over the world. And it is unfamiliar to many engineers, researchers, managers, and policy makers. Sustainable engineering can be applied to any engineering discipline. its application is particularly recommended for our infrastructure development. And the reason why I said that is because it is usually capital intensive, and it takes long time to develop and also to dispose of. Many of us looking at what we have invested in Ajaokuta, in Alaja, and so many other places, Katsina, and so more, in Port Harcourt, and so many other facilities like that, we agree with me that when we look at many of these infrastructures that have good motive in mind, there's good motive in developing them. The reason why many of them have refused to fly is because there are a number of things that are lacking in the conception, development, and management of those facilities. The benefit of employing sustainable engineering concepts in infrastructure development include appropriate and long-lasting infrastructure development. Because everybody gathered together, it is our own. We know that we need, it is what we need. We look at what we have as resources, and we try to develop, making use of what we have to achieve what we need. So it brings about development of appropriate and long-lasting infrastructure. It will also help the community to take ownership of the facility in their domain because they are involved in the process. You will agree with me, if somebody is consulted, is involved in developing certainty, he knows that this is what we have done. It's not that it is their own. And because they see it as our own, so they will take care of it and they will nurture it. And that is very crucial to our development as a nation and also as a people. It will also bring about drastic reduction in our infrastructure project cost. It will also reduce project abandonment. Like I was discussing with my friend that is here, when we were doing our industrial training in 1986 at Niger River Basin Development Authority in Ilorin, there were certain facilities that were imported to this country as at that time, and throughout the 6 months that we were there, what we learned was that the expatriate that was to come and install those things forgot the manual where he was coming from, and he has returned back to that country so that he will come back. He never returned until when we left the place. Later on, I learned that he never returned, and so many millions of dollars went down the drain, and the reason is because the local engineers were not involved in the development of such facilities. At the end of the day, those facilities became environmental nuisance, and only God knows what the consequences would have been on our health and on our ecosystem welfare. So areas where more efforts are needed in sustainable engineering. The first aspect is in creation of awareness of what it is all about. It is easy for us to say something is bad when we are ignorant of it. Until when we experience it, until when we embrace it, we will not know what it is. The taste of food is in putting it in your mouth to know what it is like. So there is a need to create more awareness about sustainable engineering. There's also a need to adapt existing engineering principles to sustainability. There's a need to develop new approaches that suit our local situation. A number of our colleagues here will recognize the fact, for example, you cannot use mobile plow here in the tropical region because that is suitable only for the temperate area. It's only disc plow that is suitable for us. Yes, it is. The two of them are engineering work, but the issue there is that each of them are designed with the location in mind. The same thing is very important. Whatever engineering that we are doing, we need to look at the end user and how do we adapt it to their geographical location, their social cultural nature, as well as their affordability. So there is also a need to evaluate sustainability profile of current and emerging sustainable engineering technologies. Developing suitable policies is another area which our politicians, lawmakers can do to incorporate this into our engineering practices. Corporate organizations also have some role to play. Implementation of infrastructure projects on the basis of sustainable engineering technology in various sectors of our economy is crucial. We need to incorporate sustainability into them. We also need to develop metrics for assessing progressive changes in sustainable engineering practices and the consequences of those changes on the three pillars of sustainability. If we do all this, there are a number of consequences for them. One of them is better understanding of what sustainable engineering is, and it will also bring about technological advancement of our great nation in a sustainable manner. I would now like to talk about what role can Covenant University play in sustainable engineering. One of the roles that the university can play is in supporting researches in some of the earlier mentioned research areas, and by providing leadership through educating the practicing engineers through certificate courses in relevant areas, particularly in the area of sustainable design, sustainable manufacturing, and eco-industrial development. Another thing that can be done is in developing and running research degree programs while working with the National University Commission on Bachelor Degree Program in Sustainable Engineering and other related areas. If we do this, Covenant University will be among the few universities all over the world that are promoting engineering sustainability and thereby helping to achieve the global sustainable development goals. My closing thoughts. Friends, everyone would like to develop. Even at the at individual level, we want to develop. As families, we want to develop. As a nation, we want to develop. However, it is very important for us to develop appropriately. And we have seen enormous waste that has been generated in our country. We need to stop that. And we need to make a change to the way we practice our engineering. We also need to have patience as we try to make changes to the way we do things, because we both record successes and we also learn to make changes and improve on our performances. But before we can be successful in sustainable engineering, there are certain requirements that need to be met. The first one is providing operational guidelines that would stipulate the partnership structure and that will bring about the procedure that we need to follow implementing sustainability. We also need to be transparent. We need to trust each other. We need to also have a sense of common destiny. We need to know that all these things will cost money and it will also cost us time. And we need to manage this effectively. We also need to share responsibilities. We need to ensure that everybody is involved and they are given responsibility, regardless of their level of academic achievement. We also need the support of governments at various levels in providing incentives and policies that will foster the adoption of sustainable engineering principles. On this basis, I would like to give a number of recommendations. My recommendations are centered on capacity building from the grassroots up, because the strength of a chain is determined by the strength of its weakest link. Similarly, it is the foundation of a house that determines how many stories can be built on it. My recommendations are divided into three parts. The first one is to the government and to various levels of government. And there are two recommendations that I have for our government. The first one is in the area of technology acquisition and infrastructure management. I would like to recommend that each regime should focus on one or two infrastructure to develop within 4-year period, just like the case of the cell phone that has been done and has been done well. And I would like to recommend that maybe the current government should focus either on energy or on water supply or on transportation. In the area of energy, I would like to recommend our focusing on the solar system. We have abundant solar energy, and this is very, very important. I've read somewhere that there is consideration of nuclear power plant in this country. I would like to strongly recommend against it. And I have a number of reasons. For a number of years, I lived in Canada. About 3 years ago, there was a plan to develop nuclear power plant in Alberta, in the province where I was living. and there were public opinion against it. And they were about to give the private company the opportunity to develop it, despite the public opinion against it, until when the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster took place in Japan. And that's when the nuclear power plant, the intention to develop it stopped, and it died a natural death. If those that are a little bit more careful than we are can think of of not imbibing or of not developing nuclear power plant, I don't know what we need to think about, because we are careful people, and I will recommend that I know we don't want to control our population by making people to die unnecessarily. Another thing that I would like to recommend to the government is the continuity of policy. It has led to a lot of waste in our country. A new government come in and abandon what the previous government have been doing before they left the government. This is not like that in developed countries. So there should be policies in place that is enforced, that make sure, that ensure that the incoming government continue the policies that are laudable and not start a new one afresh. There should also be implementation monitoring and enforcement. Particularly, I would strongly recommend infrastructure condition monitoring, repair and maintenance. I'm aware of the fact that we have maintenance department in the works ministries. But when you see, when you are traveling on roads, you find out that there are sometimes you just see the pothole. And people are passing through the place among the people in the ministry, those that are maintenance department, but nothing is usually done until when the road becomes impassable. And something that could have been repaired with just few, maybe a million naira or thereabout, become billion naira projects because nothing has been done. It's just like when you have a little tear in your clothes. If you don't mend it, it will become rags. And if somebody is not implementing or is not carrying out what he or she is supposed to do, there should be stiff penalty for the defaulters. Another thing is local technology encouragement and consistent creation of public awareness. I would like to ask governments to encourage local development and adaptation of technologies for sustainability by setting direction for all stakeholders for years to come and leading by example. And how can they lead by example? That is by instituting the policy of buying local. In other words, all government departments should be directed to buy from products that are developed locally. By doing that, they will be serving as example, and by that, they will encourage the local manufacturers. Another aspect of it is provision of publicly accessible online data banks on research results from universities, research institutes, and other organizations, and continuous updating of this data bank. I've been in various in conferences, and I see some colleagues saying they are developing new products, something that has been developed about 30 years ago. And why are they doing that? The reason is because they are not aware of what has been developed. So if they are aware, if there's somewhere they can go online that they can assess what has been done, they will be able to build on what is existing rather than reinventing the wheel. My recommendations to colleagues in universities, research institutes, and in the industry. Engineers from any discipline can effectively integrate the concept of sustainability into solutions of complex engineering problems by taking a number of steps. And these are some of the steps I would like us to take as engineers. Number one is by mapping the whole system optimization and innovation tracking onto the traditional systems of engineering approach. In other words, we need to provide a pathway for sustainability thinking in our design, particularly at the conceptual and preliminary design stage. Because at that stage, we have not invested so much into making changes, and we can easily make those changes and integrate sustainability into them. Another area where our colleagues can also take part is in incorporating sustainability education into general undergraduate curriculum. just like we have entrepreneurship in Nigerian universities today. So I particularly recommend having general engineering courses that look at sustainability in engineering degree programs. Another aspect where colleagues can also come together in collaboration is in University Industry Research Institute partnership-based short courses that lay emphasis on hands-on training and certifications, particularly in the area of sustainable design, sustainable manufacturing, and principles of eco-industrial development. Finally, I would like to talk about my recommendation to all. And my recommendation to all is that I will recommend that we need to be patriotic, regardless of who we are. I'm not saying we are unpatriotic, but we need to do more. We need to be proud of who we are. We need to be proud of where we are, because you can never succeed where you don't see anything good in that particular place. So, and that is why when you believe in something, when you see something positive about where you are, that's where you can enjoy the place and you can also succeed there. So we need to believe in ourselves and what is ours. We need to be supportive, and when we give criticism, we should give constructive criticism. We also need to be patient with one another. Taking all these affirmation steps, we make our nation achieve more desired technological development that is sustainable in the long run. There will also be an overall improvement in our people's standard of living. It will also make us to live happy. We will live in technologically safe communities without denying the upcoming generations of their capability to enjoy the same level of affluence. And it will also go a long way in enabling us to meet our own share of the global sustainable development goals. Before I would like to go and sit down, I would like to acknowledge the following people. First and foremost, I would like to thank the Chancellor, Dr. David Oyedepo, for his foresight and tenacity in implementing the vision of Covenant University. Thank you very much. I also want to thank our award-winning Vice Chancellor, and I also want to thank our Deputy Vice Chancellor, who was patient in the process of developing the paper, correcting one thing or the other. I would also like to thank Professor Atayero, who helped me in looking at my PowerPoint, as well as the 500 level student who helped me with the video clip editing. Thank you very much. I also thank the entire university management for making the university what it is today. I would like to thank my beloved friend of over 30 years, in person of Professor Kayode Simoyo, and his beloved wife, Dr. Mrs. Judith Simoyo, all the way from Umudike. I also want to thank Professor Wahid from FUNAB. I also thank Engineer Adeyemi from Federal Institute of Industrial Research, as well as all the contingent from FIRO. Thank you for being here. Mr. Lanru Faraji, thank you very much. I also want to thank all the deans of colleges, the head of departments, professors, my colleagues, both academic and non-academic staff. I also want to thank all my students. I enjoy your friendship. Thank you very much. I want to thank my brothers that are here, Mr. Matthew Olariwaju Aransiola and the wife and their children. I also want to thank my brother, Dr. Emmanuel Olaniyi Dunmade. I think he's one of the newest doctorands. He got his PhD last week from OAU. I want to thank everybody present. If I didn't mention your name, it is not out of contempt, but because of time, thank you very much for being here. God bless you and grant you journey mercies back home. In Jesus' name, thank you.
If you are clapping, can we applaud the lecturer one more time? Please, we may be seated. Thank you, our inaugural lecturer for today. Again, I'd like to, on your behalf, recognize again the presence of the Chancellor, of Covenant University, Dr. David Oyedepo. And may I most respectfully invite our Chancellor and Chairman, Board of Regents, for his closing remarks. Please, can we rise to welcome the Chancellor?
Thank you very much. Please, let's be seated. I don't know about you, but I think it's been a most refreshing, enlightening, and empowering lecture. I sat there on my seat and I tried to scan through his little brief and biography, and I saw that he came from Kwara. I said, what? I said, how did you get there? Now, more interestingly, he came from my clan. I mean, so I'm extremely proud of that presentation on two levels. One, that is from Covenant University, and that is from my own clan. I think you should congratulate me for that. Only developed people can bring about development. Our problem has a foundation that we need to explore. You call somebody a stakeholder, he doesn't know the meaning. So how can he bring anything on board? Everything in this country, it is the government. If grass grows around your house, it is government. If your rope, your bucket drops in the well when you are fetching water, it is government. If your car has flat tire, it is government. If the plumber did a bad job, it is government. And so no one is willing to take responsibility for anything. You can't have development like that. We cannot have development like that. And to show how practical this is, life in some part of the country compared with the other is a world apart. Even though resources are almost equally shared, but see, the capacity to utilize those resources to the benefit of the people is not there. So most of the time, we keep marking time, just going in cycles. Every development in every nation begins with heavy investment in education. People becoming aware of their environment and their responsibility in keeping it sane. There are certain things we will never do as individuals because of the privilege developmental process we have gone through. No matter how pressed you are, you won't sit on the road and be shitting there. And that's why I still believe that while we have such a high-level content lecture, we still need to address our basic problem. People need to be developed before they can qualify to develop the environment. People need to be educated before they can be partners in development processes. It's on, just that the pace is very slow. It's ongoing, just that the pace is very slow. And I want to believe that if there's any area government needs attention, is to review their investment policy in education. Provide education for the larger society so we can begin to experience the realities of the developmental processes. We need to get back to that. I mean, everyone here is aroused by that lecture that, okay, we can collaborate, we can begin to inject stakeholders' mentality and make things happen. But you see, the platform for that needs to be enhanced. And that to me is all about enlightenment. It's about quality, access to quality information on how things are done. And with that, we'll begin to accelerate the rate of development. You know, Rome is not built in a day, but Rome started one day. And the rate matters. If you are in the primary school for 15 years, you are not out of the place, that's not development. That's retrogression, because you have spent now about 3 years or 4 years outside the time required. May this lecture help to allow us individuals' role in ensuring that we create a required platform for development. I'm concerned. I want Nigeria should be off where we are today, by all means. But all hope is not lost. All hope is not lost. Three things mentioned as part of our core values here by the lecturer, maybe I just comment on it for about 2-3 minutes. The first two leading nations in development took off from the platform of spirituality. That tiny nation, Britain, took the whole world by storm with their deep root in God. Oxford is 1,296 years old. That had a Jesus foundation built by the Anglican and mixed together with the Catholic. And they took the world by storm by the light of life. The challenge is there's a great revival taking place in our nation. And I want us to be assured it will result in explosive development at the end. The process had begun. That's how they got it. When this awakening moved over to the U.S., the United States took the baton of development from Britain. And has kept it till now until the thing begins to wane and the nation is becoming gradually apostate. And now the fire on this side is fresh and burning. Something is about to shift. It will shift on the platform of the fear of the Lord. People walking with God and sharing divinity with God and thereby providing solution to the needs of mankind. All hope is not lost. If we get back to spirituality, we will soon regain our relevance in the pursuit of development. I am persuaded of that. I've read a bit of history to know that that is the process. Secondly, we have this opportunity through spiritual development, and we call it possibility mentality. It's all about faith in the God of impossibilities. This can be done with God's help and God's grace, and then it energizes one's drive to see it established. If anything, one of my greatest motivations in life is that God is no respecter of persons, but in every nation, no matter how unrecognized that nation, no matter how backward they may think of that nation, everyone that fears God and walks according to the rules, he will command the same order of result. That's how we got here as Covenant University. And that's how, by his grace, we're making the kind of waves that is privileged to make. Possibility mentality. This can be done. Problems are meant to be solved, not to be mourned. We don't bemoan problems, we rise up to it. And as we take positive steps, you find the ideas becoming a reality with genuine pursuit. It's interesting to know that we've never had power outage here in Canaan land since 1999. This is Nigeria. We've never had power outage here. The reason why you had some little fluctuation that some people vandalize the gas pipeline in Niger Delta. We have our own gas plant that generates our own required megawatt of energy to keep the place running. It can be done, and it doesn't need much money to do it, just much sense. It needs just much sense, and that's what the university stands for. The university system is to enhance the capacity of man to think solutions. Somebody may spend $1 billion on a thing and not get results. Somebody will spend $100 million only, depending on the quality of thoughts that went into it. That also draws from the fear of God. The closer you are to God, the larger your capacity to believe for the impossible. And of course, the third one, which is the reason why we are gathered on a platform like this, is capacity development. To take practical steps in enlarging one's capacity to handle issues, to deal with issues, and to create solutions. And that is endless. It's an endless adventure. It's an ongoing thing. The more committed one is to it, the more you discover you don't know yet. And you keep pushing and keep pushing, and capacity keeps rising. And I think that with those things mentioned, and the commitment of our people to the fact that nobody's coming from anywhere to change your story. Nobody is coming from anywhere. Syria is almost going extinct. I mean, America is doing campaign for election. What concerns you? The world will gladly watch you become extinct and make it part of their research. That the whole nation of 200 million destroyed themselves on the following platforms. One, and they'll be clapping for the lecture, and we have all died. The world, everybody is to bear his own burden. There is no day America will come and be the university of this nature in this nation forever. No. If they do, you will all be white, all of you. If you are not white, you won't be partaker of it at all. They won't. If you want to kill yourself, they will help you manufacture the weapons. Okay, north and south, east and west, let's fight. They say it's very good, you should fight. Because we need to wake up. This industry is about dying. We need to make more weapons. And they make it for us to buy. And we buy on credit to kill ourselves. I think with this kind of giant steps of, you know, seeking to draw resources from men and women in our public lectures, inaugural lectures that comes once in a while, we will be expanding people's, you know, zeal and zest to commit to development. We need to commit to development. We need to commit to development as individuals. If all of us, all the erudite scholars, took off out of Nigeria, then what do we have here? People have to be here to change the situation here. And let me conclude by saying, development will never be a product of a political ideology. No, it's a people movement that leads to development. There is no political platform for development. You can use it for campaign, it won't change anything. But true development is the awareness of the citizens to the need for a change of position. And the commitment spreads around the people, and people rise up to take responsibility, then we can have the kind of nation we look forward to. Yes, we keep having government one after the other, and that will be for life. But you see, nothing will change until our approach to issues change. Once again, I'm blessed. I'm happy to be part of this lecture. And I do believe, as we let it out, more people will benefit from it, and our nation and our continent will be the best for it. There is no problem government has created we have created problems and asking government to solve it. I don't know if you understand what I'm talking about. We are the major source of our problems. And until we address ourselves directly, the problems will remain there as an insurmountable mountain. Each one of us has a role to play. Every one of us, like the lecturer said, we have that role to the level of our own communities. I'm talking to the people on the need to take responsibility and to be part of seeing a better environment developed. There are many things that government will not have any hand in forever if you refuse to look at them and take responsibility to be like that for life. And that's not saying that government doesn't have things to do. They have a lot to do. And they have problems on their hands to solve. But the ones we have to do cannot be transferred to them. Government can come and put up an inaugural lecture here. No. The university here, in this environment, we see to that that it happens. Government come and put public lectures here, and they will come and advertise it, you know, or send it forth as a press releases after it's done. We will have to do that. So the job is everybody's job. And I pray that in no too distant a future, Nigeria as a nation will be singing a new song. One more time, let me congratulate the inaugural lecturer of today for a job well done, and for all of our guests who have taken time to be part of this lecture. And to our students, let me thank every one of us, and God bless you. Thank you.
Please, we may be seated. This inaugural lecture has brought many persons from far and near to Covenant University. We'd like to recognize a few of the persons that we have here on the list. Can we recognize Mr. and Mrs. Farotimi, who are here present from Redemption Camp? We have Mr. Olakbade John from Delhi Independent, Mr. Olutola from Bells University, Professor Wahid will soon be speaking to us from FUNAP, Abeokuta. We also have Professor Kaude, all the way from Umoh here, and his beautiful wife. You're welcome, sir. Shortly, too, you're going to be speaking to us. We also have from Redemption Camp, Mrs. Olaniyan Grace. We have Mr. Benjamin, Mr. and Mrs. Felix from University of Lagos. Dr. Kukuyi is always here with us of S Medicare. We also have Mr. Raji Olanrewaju, Director of FIRO. You're welcome, sir. Mr. Esther Bakker is from Newswatch Times Media. We have Mazi Kenechuku from Correspondent of The Guardian. Mr. Mobalaji is also here. Mr. Olutola, I'd earlier introduced him. Dr. Dunmade Emmanuel from FUTA. That looks like a relation. You're welcome. We also have Mr. Dunmade Matthew from CAVO, Ms. Comfort Dunmade, also present here. We also have Mrs. Ayeshola from Lagos, Mr. Dayo, a reporter from Vanguard. We have Mr. Ige Joseph. We have Dickness Esther. Mr. and Mrs. Oladosu is also present. They are also present here. Mr. Olaniyo, Mrs. Johnson. We also have Mr. Ademule here, senior reporter. We have Engineer Adeyemi, Director of FIRO. Can we recognize you, sir? You'll also be speaking to us, sir. We also have Engineer Komalafe here present, Deputy Director from FIRO. Some of our guests from the media outreaches are here. Femi Ige from News Agency of Nigeria is present. Saida Alausa from National Mirror. Dayo from Vanguard, Mujib Alabi from New Telegraph. We have from the nation, Adegunle. Adela introduced Bakari Esther, and then Onilani from leadership. We appreciate all of us at the appropriate time that will be properly situated. But at this point, can I welcome Professor Waheed to please come for a short message.
Good afternoon, sir. It's always exciting being under your training, your leadership, sir. I'm referring to the bishop because the vision that God has given to you and the passion with which you are driving this vision is really indelible in this country. Okay. And when I just listened to today's lecture on sustainable engineering,
I believe strongly that, well, though Professor Dunmade just gave that lecture today, but you've been teaching us all this while for years back. So thank you so much for what you are doing in this country. The Vice Chancellor too, thank you so much. We appreciate so much for what you are doing and we are actually impacting my life. And I want to say that Commonwealth University is just like my whole university, matter of fact. I bring you greetings from the Federal University of Agriculture, Abeokuta. Let me say that Bible says that iron sharpeneth iron, and that is why there's just no way any university, government university, public university, that really want to develop and impact is this country will not associate with Covenant University. So congratulations for today's lecture. Professor Dunmade, we've been together since more than 30 years ago. He was my prayer coordinator back on campus at the University of Ilorin. Also, late 90s and early 2000s, we were together in Germany, and since then we've been interacting together. Thank God so much for your life, for His grace upon your life, and your roles, how you are impacting this country. Well, the message on sustainable engineering, to me, is not just for governments, it's for every one of us. We've got to become sustainable engineers. We have a lot to do to actually help this country. The thinking is that it's only government that can actually change the lot of this country, but I think it's not true. We may need to read the story of Israel. There's this book on Startup Nation. It's a story about the formation of Israel in 1948, you will discover that it was the people of then and still until today, the Israelis as individual, that actually doing their home in their own corner to actually improve that country. It's not government itself. So we in Nigeria, we just have to do something. We don't need to fold our hand again. We really need to see how we can contribute in one area or the other to change Nigeria completely. Nigeria depend on importation. We are consumer country, and the economy will not go well that way. Matter of fact, until we begin to really develop our own products in-house, we continue to experience the kind of thing we're experiencing today in this country. Today, I understand a dollar is about 370 naira or so, and that is disastrous for this country. If we think about it, it could really, really save this country, but it is so because we believe in, or we depend largely on imported goods. We need to start developing our product in-house, and as we are developing it, we must bring in this concept of sustainable engineering. So, Professor Dunmade, congratulations once again, and I know God will really take you to higher ground.
Thank you. That had been Professor Waheed from FUNAB here in Abeokuta. We want to also recognize Professor Kaode Shimayan to please come all the way from Michael Okpara University, all the way from Michael Okpara University. You're welcome, sir.
The Chancellor, sir, the Vice Chancellor, all other protocols observed.
It's only Covenant University that can bring gain. Federal University lost him to Canada, but Covenant University brought him back. We've been here since yesterday, just like the Chancellor said, light has been constant. It was only when I was outside the country that I experienced something like this. From my university, we are on generator. And is so for some hours. Professor Dunmade has been consistent for 30 years, over 30 years. I've known him since 1983 at our 100 level. We sat down together and we became very close friends. He has been consistent, he has been reliable. The path of the righteous shineth brighter and brighter. This is not the end. More shall come in Jesus' name. We also appreciate Covenant for what you are doing. Last week I was in Abuja at Raw Material Research and Development Council Expo. Covenant University dominated the podiums. Solar car, in fact, everybody was going to. We got to our stand. Have you been to Covenant University? Have you been to Covenant University? It's just the beginning. More shall come in Jesus' name. Thank you and God bless you.
Thank you, Prof. And lastly, but not the least, can we recognize Engineer Adeyemi, Director of FIRO, to please come for a short message.
Good evening, Ms. Chancellor, Academic Board, all other protocols have duly observed because of time. I want to say that I'm very elated to be part of this program. Going briefly to the lecturer, I met him over 20 years ago when he came to work with us in FIRO. I handled a major project. That's development of a granite shella. I must tell you that that shella had been completed, patented, and commercialized. Professor Dunmade is a very brilliant person. From the day I met him, I happened to be a mentor to him for the brief period he spent with us at FIRO. I'm happy that he's making more and more progress. When he was in Canada, he used to communicate with me. A lot of references were sent to me about him. I didn't even know that he is back in the country until recently when he told me that he was to have inaugural lecture. So I'm really happy at the lecture which he has presented today. It's a very heartwarming lecture, trying to take us further in engineering development so that we can achieve the needed progress we need as a nation at this period that the naira is going down. I'm happy also that as a nation, we are going through a period of reorganization. Looking at what's happening on a daily basis, a lot of millions of dollars, naira that are being recovered by our, by what do you call them? People who are not responsible to the country, to their fatherland. All because they are put in a position of authority, they think that's an avenue for them to amass wealth and steal government fund. It's very saddening, and it has put a lot of people under terrible pressures. To pay for the schools of our students who are abroad is becoming more difficult. And we are talking of capacity building as part of the lecture that we had this evening. But we are happy at what the Chancellor said, that there is hope for us as a nation. More so when we put our trust in God. A lot of Christians are praying in different parts of the country for this nation, and that's why we have not collapsed. Assuming that what took place last year didn't take place, having a change of government, we don't know what will have happened if we continue to lavish our money, to steal government money the way we've been stealing for the past few years. Up to now, only God knows whether we'll exist as a nation. But we are happy that God is answering our prayers to change the direction of this nation. I'm happy that I'm part of this lecture, and I wish President Dunmade more years of progress. And we at HERO, we are happy to be partners in progress with Covenant University, because our main focus is also to make sure this nation develops industrially, economically. We don't want to be slaves to other countries. We want people to produce things that we need that can help us as people. And I'm happy that Covenant University has this great ambition to make sure that we develop this nation. We produce things that we need ourselves. I've been hearing a lot about Covenant University, but this is my first time of coming here, actually. And I'm happy that I'm here. With what I've seen around, it shows that there's hope for this country. With the private university having this kind of facilities, this kind of infrastructure, I was amazed. I've been hearing, but I've not been here. And I'm happy that I'm here this evening to see things for myself. So I believe that there'll be changes very soon in this nation for the better. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. As a matter of fact, two directors of FIRO are here and a deputy director. Can we applaud them? Thank you. The inaugural lecturer is from the College of Engineering. At this point, we'd like to invite the sub-dean of the college, Dr. David Omoli, to please come and move a vote of thanks.
The Chancellor of Covenant University, sir. It is my duty to appreciate every one of us that have come to this program today. I want to start by thanking our Chancellor, who out of his very tight schedule has found time to be with us, and it is always a joy to have him here with us. Words of wisdom will always come out. We also want to thank the Vice Chancellor and the members of the management team also for providing this platform. I want to especially thank the guest lecturer for imparting onto us from the depth of wisdom and knowledge and experience that he has gathered from all over the world. And we are so happy to have won him back all the way from Canada. That's a very tough feat, and we appreciate God for this opportunity. I want to thank all members of faculty and staff for being patient and being here all through. I want to thank all our invited guests. I want to assure you that we are so happy to receive you, and that any other time you are in town, you can come and enjoy our electricity again. Also, I want to thank the members of the press, because we know that you are the publishers of the news, and you are the ones that will carry this great news. Now, there is solution in this country, and this solution is coming through all of us. Also, I want to thank the general public for being part of this event. And finally, I want to thank the kings and the queens of Hebron. You are the hope of Nigeria. You are the one that we are looking forward to. And God bless you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Molle, for thanking us. Just to announce that immediately after this, we're going to be having our guest and members of Senate. As usual, we meet across there at CLR for the cocktail. So please, all our invited guests, please, you are also invited to be part of that. Our Chancellor is not only our Chancellor and the Chairman of Board of Regents, he's also our spiritual father. At this point, can we welcome the Chancellor for the closing?
Shall we bow our heads to pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the success of this fifth inaugural lecture and the robustness of its content. We thank you for how you have treated us through your Son to this very rich intellectual menu. Receive our thanks in the name of Jesus. And we pray that as we depart from here, the same grace that brought us in from our various places, let that same grace follow us back home. And we pray for our great guest lecturer that this will be but another turn of event, not the end of it. That we'll move him forward more and more. And for what we have learned here today, help us to be able to put it to work at our private level and at our communal level. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name.
Please, while standing, we'll take the Covenant University anthem. See you, Ben. Academic procession will be in the reverse order, the band.